Today, I want to talk about reptiles in Massachusetts. Reptiles are one of my favorite groups of organisms. Herpetology, as you may or may not know, is the study of things that crawl. It has the same root as herpes. I don't study cold sores, but they too crawl. Reptiles is, if those of you who are biologists are certainly aware that reptiles are a misnomer. It is a paraphyletic group. If we deal in biology, usually we talk in terms now, what is in vogue is monophyletic groups. Monophyletic. A monophyletic group is some organism and all of its descendants. Okay? You might think of something like Archaeopteryx, the fossil bird, and all subsequent birds. And so you'd say, well, birds are a monophyletic group. They have a bunch of shared derived characters, like feathers and things of that ilk. Reptiles are not a monophyletic group. Reptiles are a paraphyletic group. Reptiles are a group of organisms and not all of their descendants. If we look at what we would, but you go out and you talk to some five-year-old kid and say, what's a reptile? I mean, any little kid will tell you what the reptiles are. But we look at reptiles, we have some ancestral organism back here. We go along and we say, well, there's a bunch of strange things, we'll call them parareptiles. Parareps, something that's close to a reptile, things like pariasaurs and things of that nature. Then we had anapsids, things that don't have fenestrations or holes in their skulls. Turtles will do. Then we have another group of beasts called diapsids, things with two holes in their skulls. Apsids. This would be things like the tuatara. Lizards, snakes, and a bunch of other things that we'll talk about, maybe. Then we get down here, and we have a few other interesting things, like crocodiles, birds, oops. And if we go back here, we can stick in mammals, or some people will stick them back there. So we have a problem. If we want to talk about reptiles, what we want to talk about is turtles, snakes, lizards, tuataras, and crocodiles. We don't want to talk about mammals and birds. So we have this sort of odd assemblage of organisms that we call reptiles. That's what we're going to talk about today. So with apologies to the hardcore playlist in the audience, we'll just bumble along and deal with reptiles. And I'll see if I can deal with this. This is about as high-tech as I get.
Cool.
So what is a reptile? Well, there are defining characters. We talk about shared derived characters that organisms have. Things that would make this, not that, a reptile. Reptiles have scales that are of epidermal origin. They have claws on their feet. Most reptiles have an external ear opening. They have eyelids. They are ectothermic. That means they take on the temperature of their environment. Saying that they are cold-blooded is a misnomer. If you pick up a lizard that has been sitting on a black rock in the sun, the lizard's body temperature may be 120°F. That's hardly cold-blooded. But that's a perfectly good reptile. Perhaps the most important thing reptiles have is a cladoic or an amniotic egg. They have a shelled egg with three extra embryonic membranes inside. Those of you who have taken intro bio realize this is what allows reptiles to escape their aquatic environment and colonize more terrestrial habitats. Within this egg, there is a food source. Within the egg, there's also a little sac to receive accumulated wastes. Within the egg, there's a fluid environment so the embryo doesn't dry out. The one problem you run into, of course, if you're going to have a shelled egg, is you have to have internal fertilization. If you lay shelled eggs on the ground and then you try and fertilize them, you have a bunch of drying up little sperm blunting their heads on this eggshell. This won't do. So you have to have internal fertilization. If you're going to have internal fertilization, then you have to develop some kind of mate selection. This is all a big deal. It was kind of tough to get from being an amphibian to a reptile. Reptiles also have, this is a gharial, reptiles also have teeth that are not pedicillate. Most teeth are set in sockets, although some of them are fused to the edge of the jawbone. They're not differentiated teeth, however. They don't have cusps. Most of them are unicuspid or bicuspid teeth. Again, though, you can see claws, scales, eyes with lids. Perfectly good reptile. Some reptiles have lost their limbs. This is a fairly common theme in lizards. This happens to be an amphisbaenid from Florida. We talked about the group of lizards. Lizards are actually another paraphyletic assemblage. When we think of lizards, we usually think of iguanids or chameleons or geckos or horny toads or things of that ilk. There's lots of limbless lizards. Snakes fall into the lizard group. If you look at lizards in the strict sense, you would have lizards down here. Branching off, the most primitive of them would be the iguanids, and I don't want to break that up. Estes and all have broken iguanids into 25 families. We'd die from old age before I remembered half of them. Chameleons do come off there. You have geckos down in here. By the time we get up, you've got skinks and you have a bunch of other things. We get up in here, we have monitor lizards, the varanids. There's an A in there somewhere, varanids. But most people think that snakes came off in here. They think that amphisbaenids and dibamids came off somewhere down in there. These are all limbless things. It's hard to find out where exactly to put limbless things because they look similar by virtue of having no limbs. And not having something is not a good reason for lumping things together. But this is an amphisbaenid. It's a perfectly good reptile, which isn't a perfectly good group, so who knows? Anyway, threw it in there just to add confusion. Here in Massachusetts, we have two major radiations of reptiles. We have turtles, we have snakes, and we may have a lizard. If you see a lizard, you're supposed to catch it and bring it to me. This is important. Turtles are one of my favorite groups of organisms. Think about being a turtle for a minute. How do you get to be a turtle? Not the old joke, you know, but how do you get to be a turtle? Interesting thing. I mean, turtles, first, the most diagnostic thing on a turtle is they have a shell. The shell is a weird assemblage of bones. There are two kinds of bones. We all know this from Bio 100, right? There are endochondral bones and there are dermal bones. Endochondral bones are laid down as a cartilaginous precursor or cartilaginous model that has ossification centers, and it grows as cartilage. Once the organism is about full size, mineralization occurs, and you have a full-size bone. This is great. Otherwise, you just have little short, stumpy legs, right? You need legs that can grow. Dermal bone are bones that are laid down in sheets and by the dermis of the skin. A turtle shell is an assemblage of endochondral bones, mostly their spinal cord and their ribs, and dermal bone, sheets, flat sheets that are laid down in the embryonic dermis, and this fuses to the ribs. All of these things merge together and form a very nice, hard, protective shell. This is very cool. Seems simple enough. There's one big glitch. If you do that, I mean, like in us, here's our ribs, there's our shoulder blades, there's our spine. Well, if you fuse our ribs together and then you put bone down from our skin, our shoulder blades would be sitting on the outside of our ribs. They'd be sitting on the back of the turtle. Then your arms don't work because they're not attached to your shoulder blades. That's not so good. Somehow, turtles manage to get both shoulder blades inside their ribs This had to happen very quickly. This is not one of those evolutionary events that happened over millions of years. You first don't bring in one shoulder blade and then walk around for several years looking for a female that goes, that guy's slick. You know, he's got one shoulder blade inside his ribs. I want to breed with that guy. Somehow they both had to come in at once, had to happen to both genders, and it had to be something that was heritable and able to be passed on. Good trick. I'm not sure how it happened. Annie Burke, who is now, I think, in California, she used to be at the New England Aquarium, has several papers on that. If you're curious how people think this happened, look up some of Annie Burke's work. But turtles are very fascinating. Aside from their anatomy, other problems. When we breathe, our diaphragm drops down, intercostal muscles spread our ribs apart, we get a negative pressure in our thoracic cavity, our lungs expand, yay, we can breathe. If we're all fused together with bones, that doesn't happen. We can't spread our ribs apart, we don't have a diaphragm, diaphragm's a mammalian occurrence. So turtles have to breathe. The only place that can expand and contract on a turtle is its throat, or its axial and inguinal regions. So it has the areas of skin here around the front limbs and the hind limbs. There's highly vascularized tissue in the throat. Some species have highly vascularized skin. They use their skin if they're in the water as a respiratory surface. And as weird as it is, there's one turtle in Australia called Rheodites. The genus name is Rheodites. Rheodites breathes through its butt. It has a highly vascularized cloaca, and it sits with its butt aiming upstream, and it's just like constantly getting a giant enema and breathes that way. Well, I guess, whenever it floats your boat. But turtles, interesting group. About 250 species of turtles in the world. They are, without a doubt, the most endangered group of vertebrates going. Turtles don't deal well with human beings. They're slow, they're very well protected against things that eat them, but they're not well protected against cars, they're not very well protected against habitat fragmentation, and they're also edible. They are proteinaceous. In China, there are something on the order of several hundred tons of turtles a week that get consumed. This is our snapping turtle. It's the most common species of turtle in Massachusetts. It gets up to about 80 pounds. I think the record is 78 odd pounds taken out of Lake Rahunta right down the road. That animal was put in a zoo in Toronto and died 6 months later. So here's an animal that's old as two or three of us combined. It was hauled out, put in a zoo, and there it died. What a good idea. These things are still eaten as food. Lots of people eat snapping turtles. Hard to believe when you think about the biology of snapping turtles. Snapping turtles are detritivores, they are opportunists. When they're little, they will eat fishes, and occasionally adults will eat ducks. And let's face it, we got plenty of ducks, so that's cool. Eat more ducks. But they are detritivores. So you have all these fishes out here swimming around that are building up concentrations of heavy metals. The fishes die. Snapping turtles eat them. Where do those heavy metals go? They're accumulated in the turtle fat. So eating a snapping turtle is tantamount to just going and gnawing on a bar of molybdenum or something like that. It's absolute lunacy. I've talked to people who go to the famous Turner's Falls Canal Drawdown. This is a big event up here. Do you guys go to the Turner's Falls Canal Drawdown? It's really neat. Ah, yes, there we go. We got one. It's fun. You know, you sit there and try and guess which of the people that are down there beating the fish to death with golf clubs are hiding extra limbs in their coats. But there are people that go there just to, I shouldn't say that. We're in Greenfield, we're on the other side of the river. This is the enlightened side of the river, right? But there are people that go there specifically to catch snapping turtles that are exposed at the drawdown. And they eat. Snapping turtles, like all turtles, lay eggs. There are no live-bearing turtles. Apparently, you just can only fit so much inside your body if you have a shell around you. So all turtles lay eggs. Snapping turtles lay eggs in the spring. The females come out. So most of these snapping turtles that you see in the roads are females. So if they get scrunched, the population starts to crash even more quickly. The eggs hatch in late summer, and if conditions are right, the little turtles all hatch at once, and then they sit there and wait till as many of them are going to hatch. Then they dig up and run into the water. This is pretty simple. Sometimes, however, conditions aren't right, and they all hatch and they just sit there in this little hole in the ground, and they'll stay there all winter. And they wait till spring, and then they all come out and run into the water. It must be really boring. Little snapping turtles are lethally cute. They make not real good pets because they grow very quickly. I have one that's now 7-odd years old and weighs about 40 pounds. The problem with keeping snapping turtles as pets, or any turtle, once you take one from the wild, it's yours forever. You don't want to take a turtle from the wild and expose it to some strange diseases and then put it back in the wild and let it spread these out to native populations of turtles. This happens frequently if you buy a pet store turtle from someplace, South America or Africa or wherever pet store turtles come from. Keep it with your pet snapper, and then your snapper gets too big and you say, this is really boring, and you throw it back out in the pond. You don't know what you've introduced into local populations. This isn't just some sort of bunny hugging scenario either. It's just the desert tortoises in California, which is a federally endangered species. Several hundred thousand of those died from a respiratory infection that was introduced into the populations from captive animals. So that people got tired of as pets and released.
Bad idea.
Chelydra serpentina, the little tail grabs around plants. People thought it was serpent-like. Easy to tell snapping turtles from our other turtles. Again, tail is as long as the shell. Really neat animals. I like them. They have no protection in Massachusetts. Hard to believe. The state has no closed season on them. You could go pick up a dump truck load of these every day for your entire life, and the state doesn't care. We are trying to fix that. Another very common turtle that most people don't see is called the stink pot turtle, the musk turtle. It has little scent glands that dump out right here and right here. These are one of the smallest turtles in the world. They're about the size of a potato. They come out in the evening, and so if you go around a reservoir or a large lake and shine your lights in shallow water, you'll see these things crawling about. Also, sometimes they come out in the day and they will climb trees that overhang the water. I mean, it has to be a leaning tree. They don't shinny up a straight tree. That would be foolish. And they just sit there. So if you see a turtle sitting in an overhanging tree, it's probably one of these guys. They, too, are lethally cute when they hatch out. This animal's about the size of a nickel. They're just kind of neat things. I like the picture, so I put it in there. Spotted turtles, genus Clemmies. There's a large push within the turtle community to get the entire genus put on the federally endangered species list. In our wisdom, the state of Massachusetts is trying to take this one off our state list. Go figure. Any little kid would look at that and say, I know, that's a spotted turtle. It's black, it has spots. This does not serve the spotted turtle real well because everybody can identify it. Because it is a state special concern species, anytime you want to stop a subdivision or someone from building a house in your backyard, you run out and you find rare species. I don't advocate doing this. It's kind of it's not a good thing to do to the state rare species law. But nonetheless, one of the species that's most commonly found is the spotted turtle, because anybody can identify a spotted turtle. So there are now 600 or 700 records of spotted turtles from Massachusetts, and there's a huge push to delist it. Up here, it's not very common. You get down in South Bristol County, Plymouth County, down around the Cape, it's very common. They grow cranberries down around the Cape. Cranberries grow in bogs. If you want to build a bigger bog, you have to infringe on spotted turtle habitat. It gets real messy. They'd really like to see spotted turtles delisted. One thing you can tell from this picture, you can see these little rings. These are actually annular rings. They are more or less consistent with the age of the animal. So if you want to age a turtle, you can sit there and try and count rings. The problem is that the rings kind of get squished together when they get real old. So you can count them up to 10 or 15 years, and then it gets tougher. And really, really old animals are worn completely smooth. So you don't have much chance there. The only way you can age really old animals is to saw their bones in half and count the rings. and that's kind of hurts. Wood turtles. This is another interesting animal. It's Massachusetts State Special Concern. These are fairly large turtles. They're about 8 inches in length. The males have a concave plastron. The females, the bottom of the shell on females is flat. These are really smart animals. There are populations of wood turtles that stomp on the ground to make worms come up, and then they eat the worms. That's pretty clever. I've never tried it, but it supposedly works for turtles. Wood turtles used to be enormously abundant in Massachusetts. Louis Agassiz mentions going out with two friends and finding 100 animals in an afternoon just west of Boston in 1857. You'd be hard-pressed to find one in an afternoon now, if you looked. Wood turtles hibernate in streams, second-order streams. Think of brook trout streams. That's where you'll find wood turtles. They hibernate there. Their territories, these are not defended territories, but home ranges would be more appropriate, I guess, parallel these streams. Males may go 1,000 meters up and down the edge of a stream. They may go only 100 meters away from the edge, but they'll parallel the stream for 1,000 meters. It makes managing for this species very difficult, if not impossible. We hope not impossible, but think in terms of how you would manage for a species. Spotted turtle, the previous little turtle, this guy, lives in temporary ponds for the most part. They may live in a pond the size of this room. So in the spring, they feed there on whatever, invertebrates and such. In the summer, they estivate. Now, in some populations, these turtles will go 900 feet into the uplands and crawl under leaves and hang out there for a month or so, and then go back to their vernal pond once it fills up later in the summer. If you wanted to save all the spotted turtles that lived in an area the size of this room, you'd say, well, that's a no-brainer. You scribe a 900-foot circle around there and say, don't build in that. We'll save that. Well, do the math. You know, an acre is 208 feet by 208 feet, roughly 43,000 some odd square feet. If you go pi r squared with 900 feet, you end up with about a 52-acre circle. If you go around Massachusetts and find every puddle with a spotted turtle in it and draw a sacrosanct 52-acre circle around it, there's going to be nothing but circles in Massachusetts. And that's for something that lives in a little tiny puddle. You go to something like this that has a quarter mile long range paralleling a stream, and you draw a 300-foot circle around that, you're talking thousands of acres to preserve this species. It's a management nightmare. But it's one of our rarer turtles. The other problem is that these turtles don't interact with people very well. People, they're lethally cute. People see them and they take them home. It's just the way turtles are. I mean, I took them home when I was a kid. I still take them home. I don't take home wood turtles. I take home other stupid turtles that people give me. It's not a good thing. It's like keeping a pony in your house. It's really stupid. A study was done in Connecticut on a population of wood turtles. A fellow watched it for 25 years. Then they built a bike path through the park where these turtles were, opened access to the public, and within 3 years, the population was down to zero. It just crashed. People took them home. The bog turtle. This is a federally endangered animal, or federally listed animal. It exists in some very small populations in southwestern Mass. This is a very odd little turtle. It has several strikes against it. The biggest strike against it is it very closely resembles a sacred turtle in Japan. So people in Japan really like them. I mean, they don't do bad things to them. They don't pretend they're little turtle quality quahogs. They just want to keep them as pets. And they're worth thousands of dollars in Japan. In the United States, they're worth about $1,000 a piece on the black market. So you can see there's a fair incentive to go out and pillage these groups of these turtles. To give you some idea of how big this turtle is, there's a bunny bean. I like to keep rabbit poop and slides for scale, but I mean, this whole turtle is about 3.5 inches long. It's very easy to destroy a population of bog turtles. They need very specific habitats. They need water about an inch deep. So they need marshes, very shallow habitat. They only lay 3 eggs a year. So if you steal a few adults, it's almost impossible for the population to build itself back up. Nest predation in turtles also is getting to be a huge problem. Foxes, raccoons, skunks all eat turtle eggs. Historically, this wasn't a big deal, but all of these species of mammals are human commensals. Their populations go through the roof as we build more and more subdivisions and dump more garbage out and provide more habitat for foxes and skunks and raccoons. So these inflated populations of organisms find nesting turtle areas, they just put more pressure on the turtle nests. In some places now, turtle nest predation is well over 95%. You'll just go out in any sand pit around here and you'll just see turtle eggs scattered all over the place where these things dig them up and eat them. So bog turtles, fascinating. Probably only a couple hundred animals in Massachusetts, and the sites for them are very well protected. But very interesting little turtle. Box turtles. Box turtle's a neat animal. Looks like a little softball. This is a little male box turtle. Males have red eyes. For the most part, females have brown eyes in box turtles. This is another animal that's difficult to protect. You might find them around here. I think Irving is the northernmost record of box turtles. So if you find a box turtle in Irving or anywhere in this part of the planet, let me know. It's important. Take a picture of it that's identifiable. Don't bring me the box turtle. Leave the box turtle alone. These things live to be about 135 years old. At least one of them did. They found some clever person decided to carve their initials and the date in the bottom of the turtle. Remember, the bottom of the turtle is just live bone with shells over, or epidermal scales over it. So it'd probably feel about as good as carving your initials and the date in your shin. But it will stay there after you've damaged the bone and scarred it up. They found one of these turtles in, I think it was either Brookfield or Barry, with the date on it and these initials, and someone went back and looked up those initials and said, sure enough, in this area, a person with those initials lived at this time, and so check. And that made that turtle 138 years old. Very old turtle. Box turtles in New England have home ranges of maybe 8 acres, and they just mill around in 8 acres for 130 years. They know that area pretty well. They know where all the apple trees are, all the berry bushes, all the good places to hunt worms. They have what they call forms, these little places where they hibernate or they spend the night. They crawl down in there, live in turtle forms. They know where those are. They come back out, forage around, go back to their little turtle form. You put a road through their 8 acres. That gives them about 130 years to mill in back and forth across the road at turtle speed. The mathematical odds of a car-turtle interaction approach certainty, I think, given that amount of time. They've taken a pretty good beating, and people collect them. They are very cute. Another species, though, that's very difficult to manage because we can't find them. Unless you have a dog that sniffs out turtles, they're very difficult to find. And they have large home ranges, and they are all over the place. You would have to protect all of Massachusetts to protect box turtles. So this is a very difficult species to deal with. If someone wants to get a master's degree, this would be a fun thing to do. Put radios on a real population of Western Mass box turtles, follow them around and see what they do, and see if you couldn't come up with a management strategy that would be viable. Female box turtle, this, or the male box turtle, again, this is just the bottom of it. You can see this hinge. When this animal closes up, it pulls the front of the plastron up. That's why they call them box turtles. Again, you can see remnants of annular rings here, but you can also see they're pretty well worn smooth on this animal. As babies, they look much different. This is a newly hatched box turtle, much flatter. You can see the ribs on the back. This is the vertebral elements. And you can also see this caruncle, this little white spot on his nose is an egg tooth. This is what the animal uses to slice the eggshell so it can crawl out. Pretty neat, very cute little guy. Blanding's turtle, this is a turtle that is state threatened, I believe. Maybe it's state endangered. It's only found in Great Meadows and a few other populations throughout the state. We did this five-year mass herp atlas that ended a couple of years ago, and we found a few more records of this turtle in Massachusetts. It's odd. Massachusetts seems to be the northernmost limit for many reptiles. In the case of Blanding's turtle, it's the southern limit. Blanding's turtle is a very northern turtle. It goes from Michigan across through Canada and comes down through Maine into Massachusetts. It's a big rounded turtle. It too has a division on the front, on the plastron, so it can close up the front of its shell. Pretty neat turtle. Go to Great Meadows if you want to see one. Most of the populations of this animal are pretty well protected in Massachusetts. As is this, this is the Plymouth red-belly turtle. Lives in about a dozen ponds in Plymouth County. Seems to be an isolated population that is genetically the same as the New Jersey red-belly turtle, but there's nothing in between New Jersey and Massachusetts. So the biogeography of this animal is pretty interesting. We don't really have time to do much with biogeography, but interesting, were they always there? Was it one contiguous population that just got wiped out in the middle? Or were there relic populations of this animal living on the edge of the exposed Atlantic shelf when the glaciers came through? When the glaciers receded, did this animal recolonize down in Plymouth County? Pretty weird. Great huge turtle. Gets up to about 14 or 15 inches long. These things are enormous. But they are... all the ponds that it exists in are very well known. Most of the people who live there are very fond of these turtles. You can get in big trouble just canoeing up to one to get a picture of them. They, being federally protected, it is illegal to do anything to these turtles that can be perceived as harassment, like scaring them. This is to remind us we're done with turtles and we're going to start talking about snakes. Snakes. I know, that's Amy likes that slide. She made me put it in there. I didn't want to. Snakes. Snakes are modified lizards. Most snakes have no visible limbs. Certain boas, pythons, blind snakes have relic hind limbs. You can see as small spurs, they actually have relic pelvic elements. But the snakes we have in Massachusetts, for the most part, are limbless. Snakes can either lay eggs or they can be live bearing. This is our common eastern garter snake. If you go out and look for snakes, that's the one you will most probably find. This time of year, they're all taking up residence in old farmhouse foundations. And I get about 10 phone calls a week going, I've got snakes in my house. How do I get rid of them? You can't. Learn to love them. Garter snakes, mid-dorsal yellow stripe, with two lateral stripe on each side. And in garter snakes, this lateral stripe is only one scale row up from the belly scutes. This is important to know because the next snake we'll see, there are two scale rows up from the belly scutes. And gosh, you wouldn't want to misidentify a striped snake, would you? Garter snakes are live bearers. The females are inseminated early in the season. They crawl around all year with developing embryos within them, and then late in the summer they burp out live crawling snakes, maybe up to 15 or 20 or so. Fascinating little snakes, completely harmless. For the most part, they eat invertebrates, things like earthworms and slugs and things of that nature. They do eat a lot of salamanders, redback salamanders, things of that ilk, small frogs. But a fascinating little snake. This is our other striped snake, the ribbon snake. It lives in wetter areas than the garter snake. You will find it in marshes, and you will see, perhaps not, but this white stripe is much more defined, and it is two scale rows up from the belly scales. This snake is much more gracile. It's longer. The tail forms a much longer or much larger percentage of the body. It's a pretty neat snake, otherwise very similar to the garter snake. The little brown snake. We know this is a little brown snake because it is a little brown snake. It's Storaria decayi, named after James Decay, who was a famous naturalist in New York State, and after Storer, who was a famous naturalist in Massachusetts. So there you go. Used to be the most common city snake. You could go in downtown Boston and look under trash. Not that there's any trash left in downtown Boston, I'm sure, but you used to be able to go in alleys and look under trash and find little brown snakes. They feed on insects, insect larvae, earthworms. A big adult of these is about a foot long. So they don't go after anything very large. Maybe some small frogs or some salamanders, the red-backed salamanders again. I don't find them too frequently. I find them around UMass. I usually find them under junk, cardboard boxes and such. Out in the woods, I never find them. But it's one of those snakes that is fairly abundant, but people just don't see it too frequently. This snake, if you ask a little kid what's noticeable about this, he'd say it has a red belly, and it is, in fact, called a red-bellied snake. It's another one of our little nondescript brown snakes that we have in Massachusetts. This snake feeds, as adults, feeds almost exclusively on red-backed salamanders. It's a large red-bellied snake, would be somewhere under a foot long. These two are live bearers. They give birth to live young. They're completely inoffensive. Most of these small snakes, if you pick them up, won't bite you. Or if they do bite you, they're hard-pressed to break the skin. A large garter snake will maybe sting a little bit. But mostly what these snakes do is they poop on you. They have a very foul-smelling anal secretions, and that is their big defense. You pick them up and they poop on you. Works well with dogs, though. Dogs smell it and they go, wow, this is something I should roll in. And then they roll around on the ground and the snake crawls away. That makes it a pretty good defense. I mean, there's no way you're going to be a foot-long snake and take a dog on one-on-one, but if you can get the stupid dog rolling around in the ground, then you just take off. Works pretty well. So red-bellied snakes. There's three morphs of this snake, three different color phases. They all have more or less brown backs and red bellies, however. So easy to find. Go climb Mount Greylock and look under rocks. Be a good place to find them. Also a good place to find this snake. This is the smooth green snake. Smooth because if you look at the scales, there are no ridges on the scales. This is a beautiful, bright green snake. Historically, it was fairly common. It is not that common anymore. Part of that is because it likes open meadows. Now, you remember in the 1830s and so, all of Massachusetts, or virtually all of Massachusetts, was fields, hay fields and barley fields and such. And that has changed. So we had perhaps an artificially high number of green snakes in the past. I mean, since World War II, most of the farms have been abandoned. They have come back as second growth, at least on the Worcester Plateau, it's come back as second growth oak forests. So these snakes that are wet meadow or meadow loving species are just running out of habitat. They also get collected as pets because they're so pretty, and they make lousy pets. They just die. They don't do well. One thing that's really interesting about green snakes is they lay eggs. That's not so interesting, but they lay eggs in holes in trees. That's kind of weird. And it seems as though they lay communally. Several females will go to the same hole in the same tree and lay eggs in there, an old abandoned woodpecker nest or something. They've found piles of eggshells in these trees. So how do you figure, A, that they know there's a hole in the tree? And this thing is what, you know? It's 3/8 of an inch tall. It's crawling around looking up. Bet there's a hole up in that tree. I don't see that happening. And then after one finds a hole in a tree, how does the next one know there's a hole in that tree? Do they lay little trails, little pheromone trails all over the place so that subsequent females go, there's a hole in that tree. I can tell because somebody's been there and I'm going up. Curious stuff. A lot of biology that we don't know about green snakes. Fascinating animal. Go up on top of, go climb some of the Berkshire Hills and look under rocks, or go find a wet meadow and walk around. But looking for a green snake in green grass is pretty much a waste of time. Black racers, one of my favorite snakes. Incredibly aggressive. I've liked snakes since I was a little kid, you know? Since my mother said you can't bring snakes in the house, it was like, oh, okay, we'll show you. When I was in 8th grade, I had a science teacher named Mr. Garvey. And Mr. Garvey saw me out in the playground one day fumbling with a garter snake, and he said, you know, the easiest way to pick up a snake without getting bitten, he says, is you grab the snake by the tail and you flip it between your legs and you pull the snake out this way, and then you can reach around and grab its head and it won't bite you. Now, several days later, my brother and I were playing around up by our house, and we ran across one of these. These snakes get big. They get, you know, 4.5 feet long, and they're very aggressive snakes. So I said, not to worry. I was told by a science teacher how to do this. And I went up and I grabbed this snake, and it's moving around like, whipped it between my legs and it bit me in the ass. I said, this is really stupid. So that doesn't work. This is one of our most common snakes. Notice that it has these big sort of slate-colored scales with no ornamentation, no ridges on them. This is important. This snake is eats rodents. As an adult, it'll crawl around and just gulp them down. It's not necessarily a constrictor, although it does constrict. The Latin name for this is Colubrid constrictor. It does constrict things, but often if it's a small enough organism, it just by its sheer mass overwhelms it and eats it. If it went up to a deer mouse, a little paramiscus, it could just grab it, tire it out, and swallow it whole. These animals don't look anything like this when they're babies. If you're out looking around under boards and things around old tobacco barns or down here in the Montague Sand Plains, find some abandoned house, find an abandoned couch that someone has thrown out along the power lines, that's a good place to look for black racers. The hatchlings are much different color. They have this sort of brick red diamond patterns down the back, great large eye with a brown pupil in it, large head scales, very aggressive little snakes. Even at 8 inches long, they'll try and bite you until they get bored, which takes 20 minutes or so. But pretty common snake. These black racers shouldn't be confused, however, with this snake, which is a black rat snake. This is a state endangered species. This snake is found up the Connecticut River Valley as far as Sunderland, and then another population starts in southern Vermont, comes in from New York State. So we have a gap between Sunderland and Vermont. And you're in the middle of that gap, so you have to go find this thing. I had a friend who said he saw one in the sand plains. They were doing a bird study, and he said, oh, I saw a black rat snake today when I was in the sand plains down here in Montague. And I said, so you caught it and you brought it back so we could identify it? He said, no, I didn't think it was a big deal, so I let it go. So I had to kill it. No. If you see such a snake, these are big. These things get 8 feet long. They're our longest snake in Massachusetts. They get 1.5 inches in diameter. They have keels on their scales. Even though they're small keels, you can see these slight ridges in the scale, and it makes the snake, instead of being smooth and shiny, it makes it look sort of lumpy when it's sitting there. Some of them actually have white spaces between the scales. Just before they bite you, they usually huff and puff and get really annoyed, and you can see white spots of skin between their scales. They also have a dark pupil, but there's a white iris around it. It's much more evident in the next photo. But this is a big constrictor, and it is the northern end of its range. It's a really neat animal, needs a lot of work done on it. This would be a really fun study to get an advanced degree studying this animal. Big enough to put radios in. So you put these small radios in them and chase them around. We need to know, where do they hibernate? Do they exhibit hibernating fidelity? Do they always go back to the same den site? Where do the females nest? Do they nest communally? Do they nest, again, as their nesting fidelity? When we try and save a species, we have to know something about its natural history. We can't just go up and say, oh, we know they're on Mount Toba, let's save all of Mount Toba. You might be able to do that with Mount Toba because much of that's owned by the state. But how do you do it elsewhere? Here's an animal that may well go 5 or 6 kilometers from its hibernating site.
Does it go in a circle? That would be really handy. My guess is it doesn't. It probably just goes out and mills around.
But we don't know. It's an animal that's big enough to put radios in. There are several meta populations around. There are populations in Westfield, Mass. There are populations in Sunderland. There's an oddball population in Sturbridge. There are some records from the 1700s that say, in an effort to get rid of poison snakes, these large black snakes were brought in and let go. So we don't know if it was this, or if it was black racers, or if these people were just on drugs or whatever. But there are black racers in a place in Sturbridge, or black rat snakes, rather. So a neat animal looks much different when they're juveniles. They have this checkerboard pattern down the back with a few white diamonds in it. There's the white iris in the eye. There's no mistaking this for a larval racer or anything else. This one happens to be a Mount Toby juvenile. 10 minutes. I have 10 minutes. There you go. Which is okay. So this is a state endangered snake. We want to know more about it. I want you to go out and run around the sand plains and find some. And when you find one, then you have to catch it and bring it to me so I can identify it, and then we'll put it back. Don't do this. If you're going to get bitten, you might as well not look like an idiot while you're doing it. You know, just pick it up, take your lumps. This is a state threatened species. This is Carfophis, the worm snake. This is a really neat animal. I found these in 1968, and I was told that they didn't exist in Massachusetts. So I just figured, why would people lie to me, and they ignored it. And then several years later, I was told, wow, this is the northernmost extreme range of Carfophis. Wouldn't it be neat if anyone could find these? And I found them, I let them go, because I was told it wasn't a big deal. We subsequently found several more. They make it about as far north as Springfield, the sand plains down in Springfield. This one was found in Wilbraham, on the East Longmeadow Wilbraham town line. They like sandy areas. They are fossorial. That means they live underground. It doesn't mean they're made of rocks. They are burrowers. You can see they have very reduced eyes. They're incredibly shiny, helps them push through the sand. They only come to the surface apparently in, you know, May and early June, and then they go back underground. So there's only a short window where you can go around looking under rocks and logs and garbage. This thing happened to be underneath a pool cover that someone had thrown away. This is a pine needle. This animal was about 4.5 inches long, 5 inches long, tiny little animal. Big adults get maybe a foot long. They have a little spiky tip on the end of their tail that they use to anchor their tail while they push their heads through the sand. Dr. Storer, in 1834, wrote, the book was published in 1839, but I think he started writing it in 34, wrote that he found one of these in Amherst. I think he misidentified a red-bellied snake, but perhaps he really did see one of these in Amherst. You can see where you might make that error. It is sort of pink on the bottom, although these are much smoother and have tiny little eyes, and there's really no mistaking one when you find them. But just on the outside, the Storer wasn't totally mistaken. You might find these in the sand plains. They behave like earthworms when you pick them up. They just wiggle around in your hands and try and get back down and burrow underground. If you find one of these, you have to catch it and bring it to me. Okay, this is important. They're very weird little snakes and really hard to find. Ringneck snakes are probably one of the most common snakes and one of the prettiest little snakes we have in Massachusetts. Call them ringneck snakes because they have a ring on their neck. Some of them are orangish on the bottom. This one happened to be yellow on the bottom. Any wet woods, under logs, under structure. They eat salamanders, they eat night crawlers, earthworms, things of that nature. One of my favorite snakes, the northern water snake, Nerodia sipidon. This thing will bite you, you'll bleed profusely. They are really aggressive. And then they calm down. If you can put up with that for about 10 minutes or so, they calm down and they're pretty nice. I think I've known two people who could tolerate water snakes for 10 minutes.
They're around most of the bodies of water here in the valley. You get out in the northern Berkshires and they fall out. They don't seem to exist out in places like Williamstown and such. Even north of Pittsfield, they're pretty hard to come by. These are very large. They get 2.5-3 feet long, heavy-bodied, aggressive snakes. We don't have cottonmouths in Massachusetts. They drop out at the Great Dismal Swamp down in Virginia, you know? This is a completely harmless snake. It's very aggressive. It has an anticoagulant in its saliva that is lethal to fish and frogs. This is good if you eat fish and frogs. It makes you bleed profusely. And so people get bitten by these, they get scared. Wow, I'm bleeding profusely. It's just the way it is. They're live bearers. This is what the little guys look like when they come out. This is sort of a poorly formed embryonic membrane. They're not just crawling around loose in mom. They're all coiled up in these membranes. This is relic yolk. When the little snake comes out, they slit this membrane and just crawl out. This was kind of neat. I was called down to Hatfield to remove this wild, dangerous snake that was striking at all these people in a mobile home sales facility. And I went down, and here's this big female water snake. You know, she's 2.5-3 feet long and very grouchy. It was late May or late August. She was getting ready to give birth, and she was in a pretty foul mood. And people kept going up and poking at her and things, and she would strike viciously at them. So I got a call at UMass to go get this animal. And I went over with my little cooler, and I went to pick the snake up, and it bit me about 5 times, and I was bleeding profusely, and there were all these fellows laughing hysterically. And I finally got her into the cooler, and I took her back to UMass, and that night she gave birth to 52 young. That's where this photo came from. And so 2 days later, I took all 52 young and the mother back and let them go in the trailer facility. It would give them something to look forward to in subsequent years. Milk snakes, these are most often confused as copperheads. If people call me and say, I have copperheads or rattlesnakes in my yard, it is inevitably a milk snake. They have a Y on their head. These are constrictors. They eat rodents. As adults, certainly they all eat rodents. They're really pretty nice snakes, but they don't do well in captivity. It's difficult to get them to feed. You can buy captive bred milk snakes, all manner of them, and they do well. But wild-caught milk snakes don't like to feed in captivity. So it's best to just look at them and then leave them alone. This is interesting. This animal goes all the way, extends its range from Maine all the way down into the Yucatan and beyond. It actually gets into the Andes of Ecuador,
the same species.
And where it overlaps with coral snakes, it mimics the coral snakes in that area. There's probably 15 or so different subspecies of Lampropeltis triangulum that mimic various and sundry coral snakes where it overlaps. One of my favorite snakes on the whole planet, the hognose snake, Heterodon. Heterodon feeds almost exclusively on toads. This is the puff adder. You get it very upset. It will flare out its quadrates. It actually can spread its quadrates, or these bones on the back of its head. It could flare its ribs out. It rises up and looks like a cobra. It huffs and it puffs and it wheezes and does all manner of horrible things to scare you away. I've never seen one bite. They really try very hard to get you very scared. But if that doesn't work and you insist on poking them, they play dead. They just flop over on their back and you swear you've killed it. The biology of hognose snakes is fascinating. One of the reasons they think that these things play dead is because I believe it's adrenal glands. I'm probably going to get this wrong. They have hypertrophied adrenal glands, great large ones. They need the adrenaline to counteract the bufotoxins in the toads. If you were to eat a toad, you would die from a heart attack, most probably. Your heart would just shut down because of the bufotoxins. To compensate for that, these have hypertrophied glands, and the secretions of that counteracts the effects of toad venom. So it's kind of a cool thing. This, however, is not a trivial snake. This is a copperhead. Notice no Y on its head, just two little tiny spots. Otherwise, an unpatterned head. These are poisonous snakes. There are records in the literature of people having died from being envenomated by these snakes. very few people die from it. I mean, you would probably have to be in ill health. You'd probably have to be stupid to get bitten by one of these, or at least very unlucky. They are very restricted in their range in Massachusetts. There's some that live in the Blue Hills near Boston and a few others on the Holyoke Range. They are, as you can see, they blend in very well. They're a very timid snake. They feed mainly on cold-blooded or ectothermic amphibians, frogs, some salamanders. They have a vertical pupil. They have a pit organ, the nostrils up here. This is a pit organ between the nostril and the eye. This pit organ is exquisitely sensitive to heat, changes in heat. It's good up to a few hundredths of a degree C. So it can pick up the difference in a frog's body temperature from the background temperature. Pretty slick. And because they're on both sides of the head, it affords it this sort of binocular infrared image of what it's looking at. Kind of like in Predator, you know? Very neat. And then, of course, the salivary glands are modified to be poison glands and all that. But they're very rare. You really have to be fortunate to see them. And then, of course, the last snake that we have is the timber rattlesnake. This is dangerously venomous. If you get bitten by this, it's going to smart and probably ruin your entire afternoon. I would be amazed if there's more than 200 or 300 of these in the state. They're restricted to probably a dozen den sites. Although historically they were very common. Every town has a rattlesnake hill. It's amazing to me how many phone calls I get every year from people who swear they have rattlesnakes in their yard or rattlesnakes in under their car. And you go, okay, is it a large, heavy-bodied snake? Oh, yeah. Well, look at this thing. It's huge. This animal's maybe 3 feet long, and it's that big around. It's huge. It has a rattle on the end of its tail. See? Big thing. These are modified scales that stay on. Every time this snake sheds its skin, it adds a rattle to it, and eventually it gets too long, and some of them break off. But every time the snake sheds, it adds one of these to its tail. You go, does it have a rattle on its tail? Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's got a rattle on its tail. Does it have vertical pupils in its eyes? What are you, crazy? I'm not going to go look at its eyes. But yeah, it's got a great big triangular head, and it's rattling its tail, and you go out and it's a milk snake, or it's a water snake. You go, where did the rattle go? Well, it had a rattle. I don't know. They're really rare. And they are state endangered, so you can't mess with them even if you knew where to look.
Where do you find them?
Well, they're the most around here, the most common place would be Mount Tom. But often you see more people looking for rattlesnakes than there are rattlesnakes. There are probably 50 rattlesnakes on Mount Tom. I don't really know the number, but it's very few. And often you see more than that people climbing around the ledges looking for stuff. It's pretty weird. But they're in big trouble, and people still kill them. And people still come up here to Massachusetts to collect them for rattlesnake roundups.